overall nature of the spell. Some people like rhyming couplets. Some find them silly. Some will be moved by incantations in Latin and Greek. Some insist on working only in English. Take these rituals as a base and make them your own. In doing so, you are participating in the true tradition of cunning men and wise women throughout history, which keeps the craft a living tradition instead of a collection of static litanies. Introduction. We live in a dangerous world. Setting aside magic and witchcraft for the moment, everything we do has an element of danger to it, no matter how small. Every time you get behind the wheel of a car, or travel to a new place, or let a new person know where you live, you are flirting with danger. With a few paranoid exceptions, most of us accept these dangers and go on with our lives. The reason that we are able to do so without being afraid is that we take reasonable precautions. We buckle our seatbelts, we learn to judge people, and know how to contact the authorities if needed. The world is dangerous, but we deal with it. Certain occupations and activities increase the danger in your life. A police officer or a skydiver lives a more dangerous life than an office worker. They take extra precautions to deal with the specific dangers of their occupations. In some cases, such as a police officer, he helps others in need deal with their own danger. The path of a magician or witch also has its own dangers. Paul Husson, in his book Mastering Witchcraft, warned, "The moment that you set foot upon the path of witchcraft, a call rings out in the unseen world, announcing your arrival. Not everything that hears this call will have your best interests at heart." In order to make the craft more acceptable to mainstream culture, many modern books on the craft understate any dangers, or pretend that there are none at all. If you are one of the few who actually go beyond reading books and attending festivals, and actually get your hands dirty practicing the craft of magic, you will most assuredly find that at some point in your practice, it will be necessary to defend yourself against occult forces that have been set against you. I would in fact argue that magical and psychic attack occurs far more frequently than many suspect. Not only may you have to deal with occult, psychic, and spiritual attacks on yourself, but, like a police officer, a witch is sometimes called upon to intercede against these forces on the behalf of others. The role of protector and exorcist is one of the oldest societal roles for magicians, and is still played out today in traditional cultures. I have noted that the phrases cunning man and cunning woman are enjoying a renaissance in certain quarters of the craft these days. What's interesting and somewhat ironic about this is that the historical cunning man would have actually been in the business of combating witchcraft. Of course, the witchcraft that they would detect and rout was not the result of a particular religion, such as Wicca, but rather any type of psychic, spiritual, or magical attack. He or she would have had a professional practice, to which someone could turn if he felt that malefica was being aimed at them. These cunning men and women, the genuine ones, were indeed witches themselves. Though not necessarily pagan, they were practitioners of folk and ritual magic. I am convinced that the ability to identify, protect against, and reverse occult attack is just as relevant for witches and sorcerers today as it was for the cunning man of old. Never before has there been so much magical and occult knowledge readily available to the public. Never before have so many stumbled so cavalierly into arcane practices that were once closely guarded secrets. While some introductory books hold that the dangers of the occult are few and magical attacks are rare, experience has taught me otherwise. Weather crossed conditions brought on by our